Please welcome your host, John Gossman, Lead Architect at Microsoft Azure.
Good morning, everyone, and welcome to Azure OpenDev. In this event, you'll learn best practices for using open source and Azure together. You'll hear from open source thought leaders at companies like Canonical, Chef, Docker, Pivotal, and Red Hat. And we also have speakers from Microsoft teams who are both using and producing open source. These speakers will be demoing how to use Node and Java with Azure. And they'll show you how you might want to integrate open source DevOps tools into your Azure workflow. We also have sessions on how to use containers and container orchestrators, both to bring your maybe new microservices-based applications, as well as existing lift and shift applications into containers and onto Azure. But before we go into the agenda, I want to back up and give you a little bit about our vision for Azure and open source. You may be wondering, why does Microsoft love open source? And where are we going with it? So to set a little of that context, I want to tell you something about myself. I'm an architect in the Azure team. My focus is on developer tools and systems for Azure developers. And of course, this includes our Microsoft products, our SDKs, our CLIs, our portal, and our REST APIs. But it also includes increasingly open source tools from the companies and communities that we're going to be talking about today. My job is literally to work with the companies and communities behind these open source technologies to make sure that they work great on Azure. For example, one of the most important technologies for open source on Azure is Linux. And as a result, I work with both the Linux vendors like Canonical and Red Hat, and I also sit on the Linux Foundation board to make sure that the community and governance model for Linux is strong. This all means that I have a very interesting perspective on what's going on. I sit at the intersection of Microsoft with our partners, our customers, and the communities that are working on Azure. And I get to see how people's lives are changing as developers and users in the cloud. It's a very exciting place to be, and it's a lot of fun. I'm going to back up and say, it's actually a very exciting time to be alive, if you think about it. We live in one of these times of incredible, rapid technological change. In fact, I like to say we live in a world of science fiction. Think about all the things that just a few years ago you would have said were something you'd only see in a movie or read in a novel that you have now today. Things like self-driving cars, and of course, electric cars. And I saw in the news today that people are starting to talk about flying cars finally. And we have machine learning and artificial intelligence that are so good that we actually kind of take it for granted that we can talk to our phone and it will understand us and answer back. And we have private companies that are doing space exploration and building spacecraft. We even have space tourists. In fact, Mark Shuttleworth from Canonical, who will be here later talking, has visited the International Space Station. How cool is that? Well, in all these changes, developers' lives are changing very rapidly too. The cloud revolution is one of those times like the PC revolution, or the web revolution, or the smartphone revolution, where everything seems to be changing at once, and developers have to kind of raise their game to be learning the new technologies while still working with the existing technologies that they've been using for years. So you might have a mainstream application where there's a strong ecosystem around the technology you're using, but you might be adding new features to that thing, and you might be moving to the cloud or adopting DevOps practices. Meanwhile, you also need to be looking at new and emerging technologies like containers and serverless, where the best practices haven't necessarily been written down or maybe aren't even known. So there's a lot of burden to learn new things and all the time. So one thing I do know about Microsoft is that we understand developers. Microsoft is a company by, of, and for developers. If you think about it, we were founded by two famous developers, Bill Gates and Paul Allen, and they were building a product for developers, Microsoft Basic. And the company has followed up through that time with other innovative developer products like .NET or Visual Basic, Visual Studio. Developer productivity is actually at the core of the Microsoft DNA. And I've talked to a lot of developers at Microsoft. And one thing I've found is, like the developers everywhere, Microsoft developers love open source. We love to be able to read the code, to get our hands on it, to be able to debug it, to interact with it in ways that we couldn't do with just proprietary code. In fact, open source, you really need to think about it as it's a way to scale a project beyond what can be done in any single organization, even a big organization with a lot of developers on staff like Microsoft. Open source allows us to collaborate with our customers, our partners, and even our competitors in a way that we couldn't do in other cases. You can, rather than simply report a bug, you can go in, find the line of code, and maybe even fix it, or certainly help isolate the thing, or implement a feature that you need or want in that product. The key ingredient that backs all this, though, is you need to have strong and diverse communities. Without strong, diverse communities, none of this is possible. So Microsoft has basically a four-pronged approach to open source. First of all, we just need to make it work, right? So one of the things that we have to do is just enable these various open source projects, whether that be fixing it ourselves or helping the other partners and communities that are working on these products. Secondly, where appropriate, we want to try and add value by offering these open source products as services. Perfect example of this is our recently announced MySQL and Postgres services, where developers can use the standard MySQL and Postgres interfaces that they're familiar with. It's not some strange fork, but by us providing it as a service, it takes the operational burden off the developers for using that product. Increasingly, we are also releasing Microsoft projects as open source. Famously, .NET, for example, is a great example of this. The reason we want to do this is because, to get back into that collaboration cycle where I talked about, where we can now collaborate in new ways with our customers and our partners and literally scale these projects beyond the boundaries of what can be done just at Microsoft. And finally, we need to contribute to open source ecosystems. And this means both code contributions, and it also means backing the big institutions and foundations that enable strong communities. For example, the Linux Foundation, or the Apache Foundation, or the Open Compute Project. The result of all of this is that today, there are over 15,000 Microsoft employees with GitHub accounts so that they can work in different ways on these open source projects. But that's just a statistic. Let me tell you a couple specific stories. You probably have heard of Anders Heilsberg and know him as the creator of C# programming language, and before that, Turbo Pascal. Well, Anders' latest project is TypeScript. TypeScript is a strongly typed superset of the JavaScript programming language. But it compiles down to standard JavaScript, which means it'll run anywhere that JavaScript runs, which basically means everywhere. And Anders has been doing this entire project on GitHub in the open. In fact, as you can see, he's the leading contributor to the TypeScript project. So here we have a case of one of the most legendary language designers of all time and one of Microsoft's most senior and productive developers, and he's doing his project entirely in open source on GitHub. If you're not familiar with Visual Studio Code, I highly recommend you go check it out. Visual Studio Code is a lightweight editor and IDE. It runs on Mac, Windows, and Linux, and it's available for free download. Of course, Visual Studio Code supports Microsoft languages like C#, F#, and TypeScript, but it also is a great development platform for Node and Golang programming. In fact, recently I've talked to some startups in the Valley that are entirely Go shops, and yet their developers in the last year have switched almost entirely to using Visual Studio Code because they find it the most productive way to do Go language development. These are developers that actually don't use a lot of other Microsoft products. Well, Visual Studio Code is based on the open source Atom editor and is entirely available on GitHub in an open source form. But we don't only contribute to Microsoft-backed projects. I'm sure you've heard of Docker, and we're going to hear from the Docker company later today. But you may be surprised to find out that John Howard from the Windows team is the leading contributor the last 12 months to Docker and the fourth leading contributor all time. There's so much open source going on in Microsoft now that it's actually pretty hard for me to keep track of. Certainly 5 years ago, I probably could have told you about all the major open source projects at Microsoft. 2 years ago, I could have given you the basic landscape. Literally today, I find out about new open source work at Microsoft a couple times a week. I knew that LinkedIn had created Kafka and was its biggest user. But I was surprised to find out that Bing was one of the next two biggest users of Kafka, and it had been so for a couple of years. I found out about LightGBM from listening to a podcast, not a Microsoft podcast, just a machine learning podcast. And the speaker started talking about one of the latest things that showed up in the last year is this thing LightGBM, and he said it came from Microsoft, and I had to go look it up. So it's an exciting time to be a developer and to work in the cloud with open source. Microsoft is committed to using open source in our products and enabling open source for our customers and partners. And that's why we're here today for this event. So we got a whole lot of other things coming on the rest of the day. Next up is Scott Johnson from Docker, who will talk about modernizing traditional applications and bringing hybrid applications to Azure. I hope you enjoy the day.